Hello, and welcome to Rock, Paper, Swords, the historical action and adventure podcast. My name is Matthew Harvey.
And my name is Stephen A. Mackay.
What's your name?
Stephen A. Mackay. Okay. You should know by now.
I know, but it sounded funny. We're both best-selling historical fiction authors, and together we chat about all things historical and anything that could fall under the banner of action and adventure in books, film, TV, and games.
Oh, and we also talk about rock music from time to time.
But not today. Or actually, we do talk about rock music a little bit later on.
A wee bit at the end.
Aye. So our guest today is Ethan Bale, author of the Swords of the White Rose series. Book one, Hawker and the King's Jewel, came out last year, and the follow-up, The Lost Prince, has just been published. Ethan Bale is a former defence journalist. Despite writing about modern military technology for much of his career, he was always passionate about history, particularly the Renaissance and early modern Europe. Over the years, he's been flung about in military aircraft, trained in 17th century rapier, fired flintlock pistols, messed about in boats, and ridden both horses and motorcycles. But these days, he's usually found wielding a pen and not a sword. Welcome to Rock, Paper, Swords, Ethan.
Oh, thank you for having me on.
Yes, welcome, Ethan. So we'll dive straight into the first question. Your new book, why this time period and what made you want to include Dracula?
Well, the series began because I had been seeing so much Tudor historical novels being done. And I got to the point where I was really just fed up with seeing all the Tudors. And I said, well, what about the losers? Let's hear some more about the Plantagenets. So I thought I would write a book and I would begin it at the Battle of Bosworth. Most people might end a book about the Plantagenets with the Battle of Bosworth. But that's my launch point for it. So it follows the losers. It's the tale of the end of the Wars of the Roses from the losers' perspective. And I thought that would be a very unique viewpoint to write from, to have a protagonist who is on the losing side, because it presents so many questions. Do you give up? Do you surrender? Do you join the other side, which is what many people do, or do you just lie low? Or do you continue the fight? So that was the starting point for it. And the sequel, The Lost Prince, is really just a direct continuation of the first. It picks up exactly where the first leaves off. And again, I've always had an interest in Vlad III, Dracula, because he had such an interesting life. And because it was contiguous, the same time period, I thought I could introduce him as a character. I had to play a little bit fast and loose with the timeline and Dracula's death in real life, but that became part of the plot.
Aha, okay, so that's interesting. So I haven't read the book, I have to admit, at this stage, I was interested to see that you've got Vlad Dracul in there. And I like him. Obviously, I find him an interesting character, but I'm much more coming at from the vampire sort of side of things. So, although I've read a bit about him, and not a huge amount, but a bit about all this impaling hundreds of Turks all over the place and stuff. So, can you tell us a bit of the, you know, about him and some interesting facts about that maybe you unearthed about him? And also, in this story, are there any allusions to the sort of the supernatural, and you know, is that part of the story, or does that give too much away?
No, it doesn't. There's no supernatural element to this at all. This is okay. About the real Dracula, and yeah. Who in many ways is far more fascinating than Bram Stoker's character. In fact, I've written an article recently about the real Dracula and how his childhood, his whole development, his youth influenced his character and probably turned him into the monster that he became. He was offered up as a hostage by his father to the Sultan, the Ottoman Sultan. And so if his father had gotten out of line, he could have been executed any moment. And he was a child, and his brother was taken away at the same time. So he grew up seeing public executions, knew as he became maybe 10 or 11 that his own life could actually be in danger. But he was present at the Ottoman court the whole time. So he was treated well, but he got to see some fairly horrific things. And you combine that with medieval Romanian politics, you know, Wallachia was sort of sandwiched between the Hungarian Empire and the Ottoman Empire. So it was constantly at the center of a tug of war politically. And so the prince of Wallachia would have to, you know, basically balance both sides just to stay on his own throne as a princeling. So these things affected the man as he grew up. And I just found that fascinating. The other thing I was able to do was the fact that his body was never found. He was supposedly killed in December of 1476, just a couple of months after he took the throne for the third time. I mean, that's not bad innings when you think about it. Yeah, he lost the throne and got it back again three times. But his body was never found. As a result, you can sort of play a little bit fast and loose for fiction purposes as to, well, what happened to him. So in this book, he actually survived, and that's where Hawker, Sir John Hawker and his company come in to effect essentially a rescue at the behest of his illegitimate daughter.
Okay, so I'm guessing that the fact that his body was never found is part of where the myth all stems from, and why he was used by Bram Stoker and others, I guess, as this perfect character to say that he, you know, he's an undead. You know,
he
found his body because he lived forever.
Yeah. Yeah, no, exactly. And that the other thing that plays into that is the he was built up even during his own lifetime as a monster. That didn't happen after he died. He was the subject of the broadsheets, some of the first propaganda done by governments on the newly invented printing press, showing how he ate babies and impaled thousands of people in a single sitting. All these things were spread throughout Europe, while at the same time he was considered a soldier of Christ. He was awarded by the Pope for his crusades against the Ottomans. So it was a very strange duality of personality with him. But the legend in his own time of his infamy is really something that I think Bram Stoker latched onto when he was doing his research.
Yeah, did he actually do all these impalings? I mean, he's got the nickname Vlad the Impaler. Is it true? I mean, did he go impale hundreds of people?
Absolutely, because he had that nickname in his own lifetime. However, he didn't invent the punishment of impalement. Yeah. Matter of fact, it had been used throughout the region for a very long time, and the Ottomans were using it at the same time. He just made it his signature, I think, for a form of execution. He was excessive in that respect. I mean, other famous tales of him, because it was important to portray himself in Wallachia as a strong kingdom. When he had a delegation of the Sultan paying him a visit during one of the brief periods of peace, they refused to remove their turbans when they came into his presence. So he said, you know, you're more than happy to remain, keep your hats on. You can keep your hats on all the time. So he had their turbans nailed to their heads, which didn't go down well with the Sultan, as you can imagine.
Yeah.
Interesting character.
Yeah, I think I've met some people like that, but maybe not quite. So moving on from Vlad the Impaler, but still sticking with the Middle Ages or a link to medieval history. I mentioned it in the introduction that you for many years participated in different medieval sort of reenactments and fighting and things, in tournaments in the US and the UK. So can you tell us a bit about that and the Society for Creative Anachronism and how that's sort of influenced your writing?
Yeah, I mean, the Society for Creative Anachronism is probably one of the oldest, and I use the term reenactment loosely, because they don't actually reenact anything. They just explore the Middle Ages over a wide time period, and you can dress as any time period you want within that era. But they started back in 1965 out at Berkeley, California, at the university. And this is long before you had groups around Europe doing medieval reenactments. There were a few. I mean, you had the sealed knot for the English Civil War in particular, but they were pretty much few on the ground, whereas the SCA in the States became huge. So when I first got involved, when I was 17, mid-70s, they were putting on what they would call wars with 2,000, 3,000 participants. I mean, these were huge, people armoring up and fighting. The other element of it, which I thought was intriguing, was that it wasn't choreographed. None of it was. So you're putting on armor and you're going out there and you're really whacking each other. And the only sop they gave to safety was that you didn't use real steel, they used wooden weapons. So it became more of a reenactment of the medieval tournament, so the foot tournament. So you could have 40 fighting on a side at once, you'd have referees, that sort of thing. But I can tell you, I mean, yeah, armor, a piece of wood will dent armor.
Painful.
So it was exciting. And the thing was, you found out, and these are things, as you asked, well, how did this influence your writing? You really get a sense when you're wearing full armor of how isolated you are from the outside world. And your visibility is limited, particularly if you're fighting in a closed helm. And you can still hear, although things are muffled, but you're limited to just, you know, front, your peripheral vision basically disappears. You have to keep swiveling your head to see what's going on. So that's an important factor. Your battle becomes what's in front of you, essentially, once you're engaged. So I think that helps you understand that you don't have this bird's eye view of what's going on. You are literally dealing with the situation right in front of you. And I found that really helped influence my battle scenes. The other thing that I thought was interesting was, and I can relate this to forensic archaeology. I mean, you've heard of the Battle of Visby in the Baltic, which is a very famous battle in the 14th century, where I think it was the Danes invaded the island of Gotland or something, and they had a mass grave dug after the battle and dumped everybody in. And when the archaeologists went through and looked at the bones, they found that the vast majority of the skeletons all had leg wounds. And you're thinking, well, that's interesting. And then some of the skulls had horrific injuries delivered from the top down. So they understood that after they realized this, what happened was that people, warriors were getting taken out by leg shots, dropping to their knees, and then there was a follow-up with a kill to the head. So this is actually what would happen fighting in the SCA, that it'd be easier to take someone's leg out, and then they would have to go down to their knees, and then you're in a position, because you're fighting over them, and you've got a better chance of winning the fight. And that absolutely happened quite a lot. I used to fight mainly with sword and shield, because I'm not particularly tall person, and I really wasn't big enough or hefty enough to use a pole arm. But you get a lot of you know football players and things who and rugby players, and they would go out there and these guys would use pole arms, and I was literally lifted off my feet by a pole arm once, and I saw stars just like in the cartoons, you know, when the character's on the ground and the stars are spinning around his head. And that's only ever happened once in my life, and that was it. I was quite dazed by that, but I never had any broken bones. I knew people that did have broken bones, but the idea of the adrenaline rush looking out and seeing a shield wall about 100 feet away from you, And then the battle begins and they start rushing towards you. I mean, it's just incredible. You really do lose your sense of where you are. And it was a lot of fun. So I did that on and off for the better part of 25 years, I think.
Wow, it's amazing. It's interesting that you said it started in the mid-60s and obviously by the 70s it was really popular. I'm a keen role player, played Dungeons & Dragons, you know, since the 80s when I was a kid. And I wonder if that, because that was all starting around sort of that same sort of time, and they started off as doing sort of war games. And I wonder if there was a crossover between tabletop role players and people who got involved with the SCA.
It could have been. Well, I do know that back in the mid-70s, that people were playing the early Dungeons & Dragons. You know, people had to, you know, making their own dungeon, and you just had to bring along your dice and you find a dungeon master. So I was playing back when it first started, I think. I was probably doing that in 76.
Yeah, so that's there. Because I think when they before they even started with all the fantasy stuff, I think it was chain mail originally, and it was originally all just medieval, and then they started to add dragons and monsters and fantasy stuff. So.
Yeah, so you did have a lot of people in the SCA who were doing that, and dare I say they probably still do. And, you know, when I was reading when I was a teenager, I was reading some historical fiction, but mainly classic stuff like Ivanhoe. But I was really reading science fiction and fantasy and sword and sorcery. So one thing leads to another. And so from there, I went into trying to find how I could actually start doing medieval fighting and wearing armor and that sort of thing. So that's how I got into the SCA. And as they say, one thing leads to another, and you go from there. But I was doing writing as a teenager, mainly horror stories and that sort of thing. I didn't start writing novels till I was much older. I wish I'd started earlier now in retrospect, but better late than never, as they say.
Well, that brings us on nicely to the next question. Why the move from writing about modern military technology to historical stuff? And is your pen name something to do with that, maybe? Keep them separate?
It is to keep them separate. I mean, people said, well, you were working for Jane's, the military publisher, which I did for a number of years. I was the editor. And they said, well, you could write Tom Clancy stuff. And I said, yeah, but that's too much like the day job. Why would I want to do that? I need some escapism.
Yeah.
So that's why I started writing history. So the first book I wrote was actually nonfiction. It was history. And it was about a not so famous pirate who was born in London, but he was actually a privateer working out of Massachusetts in 1703. And he was the first man to undergo a court of admiralty trial outside of London. This had never been done before. And the reason it happened was because the Crown couldn't get any convictions for pirates in the early days because these men were tried by jury locally, as you'd expect in the colonies. So Massachusetts or Carolina or Virginia would hold a trial and the pirate would go in. Everybody would applaud. The guy, the trial lasts 5 minutes and he walks out free. Back in London, they decided, well, how are we going to get around this? So they felt if they could do a court of admiralty like they'd done for Captain Kidd, you don't need a jury. There is no jury. You just have essentially a board of admiralty. They said, well, what can we do? So they made every governor of every of the colonies, of the 13 colonies, each one was made a vice admiral of the Royal Navy so they could convene their own court of admiralty. And so my guy was the first guy to undergo this this so-called justice. And his trial lasted 2 days. And as you can imagine, the outcome of that. So the governor of Massachusetts was the president of the board of admiralty. The prosecuting attorney was his son, who was the deputy governor. And the pirate, whose name was John Quelch, which I thought was a very unusual English name. You don't see many Quelches around. He did have the benefit of attorney. He had a wonderful Scottish attorney called Menzies, who looked after him. But basically, he was told at the end of day one, you don't stand a chance, mate. It's over. So But it was fascinating writing about it and writing about the trial and what happened. And there were other instances around it, which was quite amazing. But it was actually something which led, I think, to, at the beginnings, the stirrings of independence, because the local people in Boston were enraged by all of this. So it was one of the early indicators of trouble ahead.
What's the name of that book?
It's called Quelch's Gold. And he also had some bad luck. So when he started out as a privateer out of Boston, he had a warrant to go after the French and the Spanish. But he didn't, he knew there weren't very many up in New England. So he said, well, we can go to Brazil, because that's where all the gold is. So they went to Brazil and they took about something like 3 or 4 million pounds worth of gold from Portuguese ships. But what he didn't realize was, sort of about 2 months after he set sail, Britain had signed a treaty with Portugal, and they are our oldest ally as a result of that treaty. And part of the treaty said, we must mutually prosecute acts of piracy. So when he comes back to Boston, which he did, and he paid off all the backers of the voyage first and his crew, he realized then that that he'd probably broken the law.
It's an interesting note there for people who are writing historical fiction to think about how complicated it is for communications to travel, how slow communication was, and especially if people are at sea, you know, how there was no way of getting information. So, you know, those things happen several times in history, don't they? People are at sea and they come back and the war's finished or a new war started or whatever, you know.
Exactly. Things happen while they're away. Yeah, that happened quite frequently, I think. I mean, that was part of the reason I decided to write the book, because I'd read a chapter. A book had never been written about this fellow. And I read a book written in the 1920s called Pirates of the New England Coast. And there was one chapter on John Quelch. And then it said, and he came back to Boston, where he was arrested and tried. And I'm thinking, well, if you're a pirate and you're actually knowing you're a pirate, why would you ever go back to your home port and just pretend nothing had happened? Which is what he did. So I knew there had to have been something else to his case. And of course there was.
Yeah, oh, yeah, that makes sense. So moving away from the 18th century and back to the time of Vlad the Impaler and your current novel series, your main character, Hawker, is not a young guy. So what made you choose to write about someone middle-aged? And is he a historical character at all, or is he based on a historical character?
Yeah, I mean, it was for reasons of I thought I could pioneer maybe not new ground, but by choosing someone who's not young and maybe necessarily healthy, someone who is sort of middle-aged, and in his case, actually, he's probably late middle-aged given the time period. He's around 50, but he's been fighting his whole adult life, and it's taken its toll. I thought that would be interesting to explore the idea of how do you keep up, A, with younger people if you're still trying to lead a mercenary company? You know, at what point you decide to hang up your spurs? All those things could come into it. So you get a bit of him dealing with aging and dealing with younger characters, including in the book, he has a young ward who a young knight who's just been knighted when the action of the book takes place. He's been knighted sort of a week before Bosworth. And so the interaction between them, you know, is this just, you know, an older mentor, or does the younger man actually become a sort of a replacement son for him? All those sorts of things. So I just found it fascinating to be able to write about that. And to be completely honest, I'm late middle age. So I felt maybe I could write it from a perspective I could probably feel myself.
And there's also a strong female character as well, isn't there?
Yes, that's right. Yeah,
so it's quite a good variety. And with the setting being in Hungary as well, it's something different, which we're always striving for as authors. So Were you conscious of that while you were writing the book?
Yeah, Steve, absolutely. I felt it was important. I didn't want this just to be a nonfiction Conan the Barbarian thing with lots of sword swinging and no real development of characters. And I thought it'd be important to make sure that if I'm going to have female characters, that they actually have agency, that they're interesting, they're not just there for window dressing. And so it was important to develop a storyline for the for those characters. And I think in the second one, second novel, definitely more so with Maria Hunyadi, who is the main character and actually becomes a love interest of one of the other characters in the book, not necessarily John Hawker, but one of the other characters. So yeah, that was foremost in my mind to try to craft a novel that could really develop those aspects.
I'll be honest with you, I probably shouldn't admit this, but the publisher, who's also my publisher, sent us a copy of your book. But she sent two different books, and neither of them had the title as the file name. It was just numbers. So I started the book about Dracula, and I think I read about 5 chapters. And then I tried to get it on my Kindle a different way, and I ended up reading the next book. The first book, it would have been the next 5 chapters. So I'd read like 10 chapters from 2 different books, and I was totally confused. And I couldn't understand where half these characters had disappeared to. And I ended up, I just gave up. Because I never had enough time to go back and kind of get back into it. So,
I'm sorry, you had to deal with a mashup there, but
it completely confused me. So that's why I was.
It's funny.
Yeah.
Stephen contacted me and he's like, I don't understand what's going on with this story. It's really bizarre. And then like an hour later, so he goes, oh no, I've been reading 2 books.
Sounds bizarre, but it's just the way the files were sent and how I tried to get them on the Kindle. So sorry, I never finished it, but I did try.
The novels, they are both standalone, but like many of these series things, it does help to read them in consecutive order mm-hmm. because of the character development that happens from beginning to end on each one. So the character, I mean, John Hawker is a different person at the beginning of book 2 than he was at the beginning of book 1, as are all the secondary characters as well. So, but you know, you don't have to. Someone could read The Lost Prince and then say, well, how did this all begin? And then go back to the first one.
Yeah. You've got some great endorsements on your books. You know, David Gilman, Angus Donald, Bernard Cornwell, even. So really, you know, fantastic authors have endorsed the books. Who inspired you when you were growing up or now as you focus on writing historical novels yourself?
Yeah, I'd say, well, I mean, Bernard Cornwell has always been an influence and he's been doing this for many years now. So I was reading him quite a few years ago. And, you know, I think one of my favorite novels is Agincourt. Mm-hmm. And, you know, I particularly like those things. I have read one or two of the Sharps novels as well. But I started writing fantasy because I had been reading it. So my hero was Michael Moorcock, if I don't know if you've heard of
mm-hmm.
him.
Yeah, yeah.
So,
oh, yeah, absolutely.
And, and he actually ended up endorsing one of my fantasy novels I wrote.
Oh, wow.
And he picked it up because he was writing, he saw it, and then he picked it up and started reading it because he got worried that it was writing a similar subject to what he was writing on. And and then he couldn't put it down. So that was very nice for him to say that.
That's lovely. Yeah. That's the novelist's curse. Yeah. That's the novelist's curse, though, isn't it? Seeing someone else's book pop up just as you're in the middle of writing.
Your idea.
Oh, my God, they're writing the same thing as me.
Yeah, but it wasn't in the end. But at least he, you know, it enabled him to finish it, which made me feel fantastic to have a hero, someone I've been reading since I was a teenager, and to actually like my work. I thought that was wonderful. But Michael Moorcock would write historical fiction as well, but he'd throw in supernatural elements. And so that's what my first novels were. They were set in historical time periods, mainly the 17th century, but with a supernatural element thrown in. And I enjoyed doing that. But it was essentially historical fiction, but with a fantasy element. And this was sort of before it became A, accepted, and B, popular. Mm-hmm. And now it's considered a legitimate subgenre, historical fantasy.
historical fantasy. Yeah, it's a real thing, and I have to say I find it a little bit annoying. Not any, just because I think it's like it I don't understand it really. I
but
guess
David Gemmell's one of your favourite authors.
Yeah, but I like his fantasy stuff. But that's not historical fantasy. That's high fantasy. No, because it's not based in the real world. Like, historical fantasy is when you say it's Ireland in the 9th century or something.
Oh,
but
right,
there's magic.
Okay.
You know, that's historical fantasy, right? I mean, it's like a specific place and time in our world, but there's fantasy elements there. And for me, it just becomes a bit weird. I don't know. I don't really understand.
Yeah, what I did, because I don't like a lot of that stuff either when it's really over the top. What I did was I call it secret history. And by that, I mean, it's when there's something strange going on, but not everyone is aware of it. Only a few people.
Yeah.
So, and because it was never written down, we don't know what actually happened today. So I wrote a book called Gideon's Angel, which is set during the end of the English Civil War. And it was a time of great social ferment because of the Civil War and religious ferment as well, with extremism. And there was a group called the, what would they call the Six Monarch? What was it called? The, I can't remember now. I wrote it so long ago. Anyway, they were a millennialist group that it was the coming of Christ again, and they were preparing their way for Christ. So I said, okay, what if these people get that a demon comes into their midst and pretends to be the harbinger of the new Christ, but he's not.
Yeah.
He's a demon, and he's trying to direct them. And he tells them they have to assassinate Oliver Cromwell, the Lord Protector. So that was the beginning of that novel. And so I have a cavalier who's been in exile in France and who decides to, off his own accord, to assassinate Oliver Cromwell, who he blames for the loss of his family, his estate, everything. And he comes back to England, but that's when he arrives, he finds that there's already a plot to assassinate Cromwell, and it's run by these people. And when he sees really what's behind it, he says, in order to save England, he has to save Cromwell. So he has to do a complete 180 turn. So, and that got good reviews, actually, despite the fact that it was historical fantasy. But again, it's because the fantasy was played somewhat light, except for the scenes where the demon is in there and things are happening.
Yeah, I think,
and it's a limited number of people who are aware of it.
Yeah, I came on a bit strong there saying about how I don't like historical fantasy. I think it's a certain type of thing that gets my goat is when it's written. When the fantasy is kind of used to not fully engage with the history or something, so it's used as a I don't know, like
an excuse.
It's an excuse to be able to sort of bend the rules and bend the truth of what happened. And you sort of think, well, if you're going to do that, then just make it fantasy, you know. And so if you can if you can weave in the fantastical elements into some real history, then that's clever. It's when it's sort of like, oh, I'm going to write something that's ostensibly in this period of history, but because I can't really bother to research everything, I'm just going to fluff the stuff and make it a fantasy world, you know. It's gets on my nerves a bit.
I can understand that. And of course, you have also got alternate history, which is separate from historical fantasy. I mean, you've got so many subgenres now of this. But anyway, I moved on from that, and I went into, as you just said, I went to straight fantasy. So I started writing epic fantasy, completely made up world, all that sort of thing, world building. I did two novels of that. And then I've decided, actually, I don't want to do that anymore. And I said, let's just do straight historical fiction.
So I think at this point, so it's interesting because we've introduced you. It's as if you've got like two novels, but you've obviously written loads and loads of novels. So I think we're going to have to give your other writer's name or other names that you've written under for people to know and go and investigate these books. So do you want to tell us how many books have you written and what's the name that you've written them under?
Well, I've written six published novels. And my previous novels before the John Hawker series were published under my name, which is Clifford Beal. And I was the editor of Jane's Defense Weekly for a number of years. And so I did start publishing under my actual name, which I think maybe was a mistake. People said, my God, what is he writing? They might have been expecting a history of the of the battleship or something.
Were instead, they 15 or something?
Yeah. So anyway, but when I placed these latest novels, the John Hawker series, my publisher thought it might be an idea to adopt a pen name, really to, you know, to draw a line, you know, between what I'd written before, which was mainly the fantasy stuff, and then historical fiction. And I didn't disagree with that. I thought it was a good idea. And many people do that. They'll write different genres under different names. Mm-hmm. And I think it helps.
Absolutely. Them. Yeah.
So I adopted that. So I became Ethan Bale.
Yeah, we've talked about this a lot, actually, with other writers and, you know, ourselves as well, about whether to write different genres under different names. Have you noticed, have the sales for this new series been good? I mean, have you noticed an improvement or has it been worse? Do you think that you could have benefited from carrying over, you know, the readers of your previous books to these ones, or, you know, how's that worked for you?
Yeah, I think, well, the sales are going well on this, and I don't think I would have carried many readers over from from that. As a matter of fact, I'm not sure. I will get readers who are interested in the Dark Ages, like you guys. So, I mean, to read 15th century, as you know, people really drill down into the time periods they like to read about.
Yeah, so, definitely.
You know, so that I think that's one of the risks when you do write about a very specific period in time, is that, you know, automatically people who are only interested in that period will read it. People who aren't, they, you know, they might try it out. You never know. But I mean, I'll level with you guys. I haven't read very much Viking stuff. I know Angus Donald very well, and I've read his books. And believe it or not, I'm reading Wolf of Wessex right now. So, and I'm enjoying that. So, you know, I've reached the point where actually I would like to start reading that sort of thing in that time period. And it helped that I moved to Battle in East Sussex. So I'm very near the old Hastings battlefield. That got me interested. So, you know, it's sometimes events in your life, or even watching television or seeing a film, makes you say, I think I want to try and, you know, dip a toe into a new time period and read about it.
Yeah. I'm really interested. I've got particularly interested in this whole thing of the name with the genre, because I'm writing a book at the moment that's set in the 19th century. So I've done such a 1,000-year jump. I'm a little bit worried that I'm going to lose, you know, some readers are just going to say, well, I don't want to read that. Well, I don't want to read 19th century.
Guns and stuff.
Yeah, I think it's inevitable that will happen, but hopefully people just like your style enough that they'll stick with you and give you a go on the hopefully. New time period. So yeah, definitely.
So we'll see. Yeah, that we'll find out next year.
Yeah.
we'll have lots of podcasts of me just crying.
So do you write novels full time now, Ethan?
I do. I'm retired now from the day job. I'm not a journalist anymore. And I can spend much more time on writing, and I enjoy that. And also, as you know, writing historical fiction is a huge amount of time required for research. And, you know, Matthew, now you've dipped a toe into the 19th century. You know, it's a steep learning curve, isn't it? When you have to.
Oh, yes.
Because you know, probably the 10th century and the 8th century and the 11th century inside and out. But then when you move up that far, it's a steep learning curve. And was for me on the Wars of the Roses, because although I enjoyed reading occasionally about the, you know, that time period, the, you know, the 15th century, I really didn't know that much about it. So it required a lot of research, because the politics was so complicated.
Yeah. And to be honest, I don't feel like I really fully understand the period even now, you know, and I'm doing the edits now. I'm going through and sort of diving deeper into some of the bits and trying to make it all hang together. But there comes a point when you just got to write the bloody thing. You know, you just got to think, well, just hopefully you know enough that you can make it work. But I feel the same way about the early medieval, to be honest. I mean, people say, oh, you know, you're an expert in the early medieval period because I've written all these books. But and I always feel like I don't really know enough, and people always know more. But it's
well,
a good story,
it,
isn't it?
Yeah, the issue with that, I think, is that, you know, years ago, before the invention of the internet and Google, I mean, writers really had luxury that they would know that 9 out of 10 readers wouldn't have a clue if they had gotten it right or wrong. Now you can Google anything. And so I think historical writers, both nonfiction and historical fiction, you've really got to be on your toes because you'll be caught out. Mm-hmm. People will give you bad reviews on Amazon saying his history is complete cobblers.
It's a classic thing. Just this week, actually, I messaged Stephen about it. Got my new book's coming out in September, A Day of Reckoning. Get a quick plug in there. And that's the third one in a series. And someone's obviously picked up this early advance copy off of NetGalley. Looks like they haven't read the previous books in the series. And so gave it 4 stars, which is nice, you know, but says basically the only thing they say about it in the review is 2 or 3 lines. It just says, and the one thing I have to say, though, is that, you know, the sails weren't made out of wool. This is complete rubbish. And I don't normally reply to reviews because you shouldn't, but I did on Goodreads. I replied and I just said, that's fine that you think that, but you're wrong, you know. And I spent a lot of the second book talking all about this, a whole historical note about how I didn't think that they'd be made out of wool, but when I did some research, they really were. The Viking sails were made out of wool, and so I said this, and then she replied, oh, fair enough. She then replied and said, I hadn't realized, you know. And so I think she sort of, but she didn't change her review. You know,
I don't think she believed you, Matthew.
You don't think she believed me?
It doesn't sound like it. She was still kind of arguing with you as if you were wrong.
Well, that's it. Yeah. I don't know. I mean, what can you do? I mean, the archaeology doesn't lie. I mean, they've actually found these things. You know, it's the facts, you know. You can't really argue with the facts, but apparently you can.
Well, you can, because some people don't want to hear the facts. Don't like to be proved wrong. I never reply to bad reviews.
No, I don't. I mean, that's the first thing I've replied to in 5 years, because, you know, normally you don't. It's just because it's a point of, you know, they've just basically said something completely wrong. They've not panned the book, but they've just said, you know, this is wrong, as if I haven't done the research. And it just annoyed me so much. I thought, come on, really? You think I'm going to write about Viking boats and not work out what the sails are made of? And then I'm going to draw attention to it? Why would I talk about the, you know, the sails being made of wool unless it was the thing? You know, it's just crazy.
Yeah, exactly. Well, I mean, I get wound up when I do see those, but you know, I'll throw the laptop across the room, but I won't reply. So, as much as I'd like to,
But it's funny because if it was a negative review, Goodreads would come up and say, "Are you sure you want to reply to this?" Because I've had that before. If you leave a comment on a negative, they comes up with a warning. It says, "You know, are you sure?" You know, it's negative. But this is a positive review, so it doesn't come up with any warning. It's like, you're okay. Because I do reply sometimes to positive ones just with thanks for the great review or something. And that always goes down well. People are happy with that. But in this case, it was thanks for the nice review, but you're wrong.
Yeah, indeed.
So you say you're writing full time now, doing lots of research stuff. So do you are you writing every day? What's your writing routine like? Have you got some word count that you aim for every week or every day? And do you plan your novels, the whole thing? Have you got the plot all mapped out? Or,
well, I hope my editor isn't listening to this, but I'm not one of these people who gets up at 5 a.m. and writes it like 6 hours every day. I can't do that. And when I motor on, I really motor on, but sometimes I might not write for a couple of days. But what I find helps me, if I really don't feel I'm ready to sit down at the keyboard, I'll get out my notebook and I'll do a very rough outline of what I think I'm going to write in the next chapter. And that actually helps center my thoughts and gets me ready to get to the keyboard, usually the next day. You know, I've got my own style, I think, like many writers. And as you guys well know, there is no right or wrong way. The only thing is meet your deadlines, and how you do that is really up to you. So I
think that's a really good suggestion, though, that you've said. It's like if you're struggling maybe to know what, you know, how to write the next scene, just try to think through some of the points that you want to cover and, you know, a bit of the detail of the next chapter that you're going to write. And then every now and again, I think that's what people think, they've got writer's block.
Yeah, exactly.
When they kind of hit one of these walls and it's difficult. And you sometimes need, like you say, just to jot down some ideas or go for a walk and just think things through, talk to someone else about it. That's sometimes that helps. I mean, I've had recently with the book I'm writing, I was getting to the sort of conclusion. I had so many moving parts, much more than I anticipated when I did the plan. Because when you actually come to write, you know, more characters have appeared and things have changed. And I got to the end and I was like, oh my God, I've got all these bits. And in the end, I just talked it all through to my wife, and she kind of just said, okay, well, that's not as complicated. And as she sort of listened to me, it all sort of fell into place. And I thought, okay. She just had like one line. She said, one suggestion. She said, well, why do you need to have everybody go there? Why couldn't they go to this other place that they were in before? I was like, you know what? That worked. And to start with, I said, no, it doesn't work. And the timelines don't work. And I went away and I thought, she's right. There's no reason why they couldn't. And it just all clicked.
Yeah. Yeah. And I don't encourage people to do this in longhand. Don't sit at the keyboard and try to make these notes. Just get a piece of paper or a notebook. I use those Moleskine little notebooks and I'll just sit down and have a cup of tea and just, you know, just freewheel in my mind about the characters and, you know, what are they facing. Another good trick I do is, if I don't quite know the structure of that chapter, it's going, I deal in emotions. What are the characters, if you've got two or three people you might be dealing with in the next chapter, what emotions are they experiencing at that point in the plot? And that will jumpstart me sometimes to get me motivated enough to actually sit down and write the actual chapter. So, yeah. Yeah. I can't remember what the other aspect you said
basically, do you plan the whole novel in advance?
Yeah. Panster or a, what was it called?
Yeah.
Panster
or plotter.
A panzer or a plotter.
Yeah. Well, I think it depends on the book. I mean, I have written books where I'll tell you what required the most plotting. And that was this epic fantasy, high fantasy, two novels I wrote. Because of all the world building, even I forgot, what the hell have I created here? You know, and it's, your maps, everything. It was insane. So I really needed to, I got to the point where I went out and bought a whiteboard and stuck it up in my office, because I had to say, okay, well, this is happening here and this is happening there. So that took a lot of effort to do those. But most of them, really, I'm a panster. I just sit there and I go from one chapter to the next without a major outline. I mean, I have heard about some writers who, it turns out that their outline was longer than the actual novel. I mean, and I'm thinking, well, what the hell's the point of that? But, you know, that's definitely
like
not,
you said,
not me.
There's no right or wrong, is there? I mean, that's the thing.
No, if it works for them, to me, it sounds like twice the effort. But
yeah, absolutely. Yeah, I think I'm a plotter at the novel sort of level, and when it comes to the actual chapters, I'm much more of a pantser, which is why by the end of the novel my original plan is kind of slightly deviated. I sort of know where it's got to go, and so I've planned out the sort of these tentpole moments, but how I get from one to the next is a little bit loose and gives me room to breathe and sort to get stuck.
Yeah, and I agree. That's exactly what happens. That's often where I'll get stuck, is I know there's going to be a major transition there, but I'm not quite sure how to make the leap. And when you're writing historical fiction and you've got you've got an internal timeline of the story you're telling, you know, what if there's a jump in, say, a couple of months between this scene and the next scene, and the passage of time, and how do you handle that, and what's happened in between, how much does the reader have to know, how much can they pick up as they read along, all those sorts of things. You know, these Hawker novels, as I said, they begin at the Battle of Bosworth, but it's continuous. I mean, I do have a couple of, at the beginning, I think I use a flashback in the beginning, the prologue, which involves the princes in the tower, and Sir John Hawker's involvement in that. So there's all of these elements in it, but basically, it paces, except for that, it goes along. The whole book is told on a single timeline. which helps. But then again, how much info do you put in? It just goes right along, and it ends in Venice, and the second one picks up in Venice. It was fairly logically plotted, I think.
So what's next after this, then? More Hawker novels?
Yeah, there's at least one more Hawker novel, which I'm writing now, and that'll be out next summer, just like Lost Prince came out on the 6th of July, and the third Hawker novel will be out next July.
Yeah.
And that pretty much is taking up all my mental ability at the moment, just trying to carry on with that. I did write a novel during lockdown, which was a fun exercise. And, you know, again, Matthew, going back to, you know, taking a trip in a different time period, I wrote a mid-20th century sort of family murder mystery thing set in my home state of Rhode Island. And it was fun writing it because, A, I knew the locale I'd set it in. It was great. It was like a palate cleanser because I was writing about something I'd never written about before. Mm-hmm. I set it in 1968, and I do remember 1968, even though I was a kid. So again, you can really give it a certain amount of reality because you can remember a lot of the elements to it. I just have to hope that the people who may read it will remember it, because otherwise it doesn't really matter.
Well, but that's just the whole thing with like historical. I mean, that in effect is historical fiction, isn't it? It's over.
Yeah, it's like 50 years, isn't it?
It's historical fiction. So with all historical fiction, it's how much detail, you know, do you need when you're doing the research and you read all this stuff and you sort of think, how much do I need to actually put in to give it that sense of authenticity? And do people actually care? Do they know? I mean, I think it all sort of exudes out of it, doesn't it? And hopefully people read it and it just feels real and believable. And
natural.
They don't think about the details.
Yeah.
But have you had that one published, or is that one sitting?
No, that one's still, that's still waiting. I mean, it's not quite ready for prime time, as they say, but hopefully it will be. But again, it's, you know, I'm not one of these people who's very good at working on multiple projects at the same time. I really have to do one and then finish that and then move on to the next. So it's sort of on the back burner at the moment, although it's largely done. It's written. It just needs some tweaking. I really do hope I can get that published. That would probably come out under Clifford Beal, I should think, and not Ethan Bale. So,
right.
Because again, that would confuse people all over again.
Oh, you could have a new name. You could have a new name. A new one.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So, yeah. So that, yeah. But, you know, I enjoy, I've always enjoyed thrillers and mystery. And we mentioned David Gilman, and, you know, I love his Englishman series. I enjoy a good thriller, contemporary thriller. I've always read that sort of thing. And I don't know if you guys have ever been into noir at all, like Raymond Chandler and James Ellroy. And
the closest is like H.P. Lovecraft.
Oh, yeah.
But that's which is not really noir, but it's the closest I've come to it.
Yeah, he wrote some detective stuff too.
Yeah, Call of Cthulhu's kind of like that.
Yeah, that's right. Because he's from my home state.
Exactly. Well, that's why as soon as you said Rhode Island, that was what popped into my head.
Yeah.
You know, I've read a bit, but I'm not massively into noir, but yeah, I've read a bit.
Yeah.
But I think there's noir elements, I think probably more from films that I've watched, I think have been sort of the noir elements of storytelling sometimes sort of filter into the darker side of some of my stories, I think.
I keep thinking
this one I'm actually writing at the moment, it's 19th century, but I think about that, there's certain elements in there that are quite that sort of dark sort of noir side of things, where investigating a crime and trying to work out all the who's involved and some of the strange motifs. And
And it does give you fertile ground for developing characters, because they're conflicted, or they might have a dark side to them. They may have done something horrible before. And again, my character in the Hawker novels, Sir John Hawker, has a lot to answer for as a younger man. And this is sort of a cross he bears, and things he did in his past affect the way he treats situations that he comes across in his present. And I think, again, that can really provide some good, some good situations that hopefully the readers will enjoy when they see this kind of characterization and the conflicted character who isn't necessarily a white hat. He's gray, as most people are, you know? So I think when you can deliver on that, you can really have a good novel on your hands if you can manage to get that right.
Yeah. So, well, we've covered lots of different ground. We're getting to the end of our time, and we always ask the same questions at the end to everybody. And the first questions are for me, which are, what have you been reading and watching recently, Ethan?
Right. Well, reading, I'm currently reading The Romantic by William Boyd. So This is historical fiction, but it's more on the literary end. And it's an enjoyable novel, and it's set in the very early 19th century, and it's sort of has an eponymous character who you follow, and he manages to end up in all these situations. He fights at Waterloo by accident and all these sorts of things. So it's an entertaining novel, and it's very warm-hearted, so I'm enjoying that. But I've always been a very omnivorous reader. I mean, I don't stick with a particular genre or time period, so I try to dip in. And as you get old, you realize there's certain novels, the great novels, and you're thinking, am I ever going to get a chance to read that? So you finally clear the deck and say, I'm going to read it right now. So just a couple of months ago, I read The Leopard by Lampedusa, which is supposed to be one of the best books written in the 20th century. And it's sort of a sad story because the author, who lived in Sicily and was a minor nobility, and he's written this novel set during the reunification of Italy. It was turned into a film with Burt Lancaster in the early 60s. It's a beautifully written novel. The prose almost brings tears to your eyes, mainly because you realize you'll never write that well. And I just couldn't believe how good a novel it was. But this fellow, it was the only novel he ever wrote. He wrote it when he had terminal cancer, and he spent his last year desperately trying to find a publisher for it so he could see it published. Mm-hmm. And he didn't. He died, but his nephew managed to get it published to great acclaim instantly. Option for a film within 2 years, Hollywood film. And it really is a wonderful novel.
Written in Italian or in English? Originally?
Written in Italian, translated a year later into English, and it became
You read it in English?
I read it in English, yeah. It became an international bestseller.
So who's the translator? Because you're saying the prose is wonderful, but surely you're reading the English prose.
Yeah,
so
I suppose.
That's a good point.
Yeah, and I can't remember the name, but I guess that's the trouble with being a translator. You're not the one who gets remembered.
Well, increasingly, just in the last year or two, there's a lot of talk about getting more awards for translators now for things, aren't there? Because of that very thing, because it's such a huge task.
That's right. I think it's well deserved. And I know the Society of Authors has really been pushing for that and recognition. And as you say, to establish more rewards for translators. I think the only other book I think I really want to mention is a book which, when I'd read it, affected me greatly. And I think you guys mentioned this in one of your podcasts, Lonesome Dove.
Yeah, Matthew Lonesome Dove.
I just thought
it's my favorite book. It's like up there.
It's just incredible. I mean, I read it during lockdown, and I'd never read it. I'm an American, you know, but I'd never read a Western my whole life. And I said, well, if I'm going to read a Western, I'm going to choose Lonesome Dove. I saw the TV series years ago in America.
Yeah. And that's great, too.
But, yeah. And I just couldn't put it down. So I read the whole series. What is it? Three books or four books or something? Three books.
There's a few, but it's definitely the best of the bunch.
They get
increasingly not as good as they go on.
Jeez, I hope that doesn't happen to me. God.
I always worry that it does, that it's going to happen to me as well. But but he wrote so many things. I mean, Larry McMurtry wrote so many amazing books, but of those specific, that series of those characters, Lonesome Dove is just like perfection, really, when it comes to writing a massive saga. I mean, it's incredible. And then he you can sort of tell his publishers must have said, you know, or he thought, or whoever, you know, said, or his agent, someone says, you know, come on, this is amazing, write another one. He's like, oh, okay, yeah. You know, goes back, revisits it. And the second one he wrote was Streets of Laredo, which is like the sequel. And that was, you know, it's very good, but it's not quite as sparkling. And then he goes on to write some prequels, and with each one I found the prequels are getting slightly worse, you know.
Yeah, so, Comanche Moon and they get
Dead Man's Walk,
increasingly bloody and bleak, very bleak as well. So
I can't find Comanche Moon anywhere. It's I think I read it originally when it came out, you know, years ago, but I lost all my books when I moved from Spain. I got rid of all my books. And I've been looking for an audiobook because I've listened to the other ones, the audiobooks, and it's not available on audio. Comanche Moon, probably for a reason.
Yeah. It'd be too upsetting for people, I should say.
Maybe.
It really is bloody. It's funny because I had a friend who read Hawker and the King's Jewel, and he said, my word, it's extremely violent. And I said, well, it is set in the Middle Ages. And then I said, but I didn't think it was particularly violent. And then I picked up Bernard Cornwell again. And I'm thinking, oh, my word. I mean, he's got 10 times as much blood as I do in mine. So,
yeah, you know, I've had
my wife
reviews,
says
people
that.
Saying,
yeah.
People saying that one of my reviews years ago, I remember complaining that one of my books was really violent. There was some specific scene of violence they didn't like or something. And they said, oh, Bernard Cornwell's much better. And I sort of went, what? And I was reading at the time, I was reading a Bernard Cornwell book, and it was like terrible. You know, I'm not panning Bernard Cornwell. I mean, he writes great books, but I mean, you know, it's like readers can sort of turn a blind eye to how much violence there is in a book that they like. But for some reason, they'll latch on to specific bits of violence, perhaps in a different book. But maybe it's the way it's portrayed or something. But
no, it's a good point. I think you're right. I think it has to do with, as you say, if the reader's really into that particular writer, they probably aren't quite as judgmental about that. Yeah. Yeah.
Well, this brings us on to our last two questions. What have you been listening to? And do you listen to music when you write?
Right. Well, I have really eclectic tastes, partly because I've been listening to music for so many decades now that I listen to everything, 60s, 70s, 80s. You know, I have to say I'm not really into contemporary pop very much, but, you know, classic stuff. And I still think the 70s were the greatest decade for music. Not that it was all great, but that you had so much music, popular music, coexisting. Genres. You could have jazz, funk, rock, metal, disco, all in the same decade, all at the same time, pretty much. And, you know, they didn't always coexist happily together, but you could pick and choose what you liked. I just thought that was amazing. And maybe it's showing my age. I think a lot of popular music today just all sounds the same. But I suppose they were saying that in the 1960s. People from the 40s were saying that. So I don't know. But,
probably,
you know, I love Steely Dan. I listen to Steely Dan quite a lot, probably more than is good for my health. I try to, and, you know, my wife never listened to it very much. Now she can't stop listening to it. So I think there's something in the water, as they say, because, you know, she loves it as well. What else am I listening to a lot? You know, I listen to, you know, the Talking Heads. I love David Byrne because I've even post Talking Heads, you know, an amazing performer and singer and writing very deeply his music. Jethro Tull, I quite like.
And there you go.
You had Ian, there you go. Yeah, Ian Anderson. I mean, again, I've been listening to him since the early days, since 72, 73. Always liked it. And I'm still listening to him.
Have you listened to the new album?
I haven't listened to the new album yet. No, I haven't.
Yeah, you should. It's pretty good.
No, I listened to one of the tracks on Spotify. I forgot which one it was, but I haven't listened to the whole album yet. But I quite enjoy it. And I do. And I, you know, do I listen to it when I'm composing and I'm writing? Well, I do, but I used to do it much, much more. So the first novel I wrote, I had, you know, Howard Shore, Lord of the Rings, on all the time.
Everybody
says that, yeah.
And it did help. And then other novels, I wouldn't, because I was so having to concentrate so much. I'd have the music on, but I wasn't even hearing it.
Mm-hmm.
And then I realized, oh, it's over. I didn't even realize that it was over. But lately, I have, with the Hawker novels, I have started at times, not always, putting on, you know, music, you know, sound, you know, score, film scores, mainly sometimes classical. I love James Horner. I like Alan Silvestri. If you've put on the Predator, you know, soundtrack, you put that on when you're writing a battle scene.
Yeah.
That's pretty good. Yeah, so I do, but it's, I can't say it's a hard and fast rule for me that I will always have, you know, music on when I'm writing, but I do it a fair amount, I think. Yeah, definitely. And it does help, particularly, if I had to choose what's the favorite music for me to write to, it's got to be Howard Shore and his music for the Lord of the Rings and then the Hobbit trilogy as well. It's just wonderful. It gets me in the mood to write, at least, you know, from a to write stuff that's set in the Middle Ages anyway.
And there's everything there, isn't there? There's all gamuts of, you know, there's battles, there's lyrical stuff, there's romantic music. In Howard Shore, he's got basically everything in those trilogy of movies. It's incredible.
Yeah. Yeah, that's right. And that's why it works for me, is because it's got all of those different feelings in it, depending on whatever scene you're trying to write.
Yeah. Sometimes I find I'm listening to something like that and you'll be writing some sort of, I don't know, touching conversation between two people, and suddenly it kicks into like a big battle scene in Khazad of Doom or something. You think, this is not working. What's happened? You got to sort of stop for a second and change the playlist, you know, because sort of this feels weird.
Yeah.
But drums in the deep.
Drums in the deep.
Anyway, well, I think we're out of time, and it's been a pleasure having you on. Thanks very much for coming on and talking to us about your books and writing and
I didn't even
life.
Get to talk about Mad Men with you.
Oh, well, you can tell us about Mad Men. Yeah, I did ask you what you've been watching, but we ended up skipping over it. So yeah, well, before you go, tell us about Mad Men.
Yeah, I'm watching Mad Men for I think it's the sixth time.
Wow.
Now, I just love the storytelling in that and the characterization and following all these character arcs and really nailing that time period down of, you know, the 1960s. And, you know, as a writer, I really admire it. And I'll turn to my wife when we're watching it, and I'll just give her a wink. I say, that is good writing. That is good screenwriting. And, you know, so I think that's that I just can't get enough of it. And we're already saying, what are we going to do now when it ends? Well, we'll have to watch it again.
That's interesting. I've never seen it. I should give it a try, definitely.
Yeah, it's going back in time. I think they do a great job of the 1960s and all the casual misogyny, the racism, but it's not handled in a heavy, hitting you mm-hmm. over the head mm-hmm. format. You start to see things from that time period and that perspective. And then also how things change, because it starts in 1960 and it ends in 1969. So again, you see a lot of character development in that time period. So yeah, so it's, I fully recommend Mad Men if you haven't seen it.
Brilliant. Excellent. Well, okay. Great recommendation. And I hope everybody goes off and reads some of your Ethan Bale books and your Clifford Beal books.
I think at least one of your Ethan Bale books is on special offer on Amazon.
It could be, yeah.
99 pence, I'm sure it is.
Oh, yeah, it is, yeah. That's the, actually, is it? That's the first one, is 99.
Oh, there you go.
99p.
So.
And it's also available as an audiobook if you have Kindle. I was particularly pleased with the audiobook. They got a very good actor to do the narration for it. And it was interesting. It's like, even had me interested, and I wrote the thing. I know how it ends.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's a sign that's of a good narrator, isn't it? That's great.
There you go. Listeners can go out and buy that for 99 pence and get the Audible edition cheaper as well.
Yeah.
Well, best of luck
with the third novel as well, and with everything else, all the whatever you choose to write afterwards, and maybe sometime in the future we'll get you on and talk about whatever's the next one.
All right. Well, thank you very much for having me on the show. Thank you.
Yeah. Thank you, Ethan. That was great.
Thanks very much. that's it for today's episode. We hope you've enjoyed it. If you have, please take a moment to leave a review on whatever platform you're listening on, and don't forget to subscribe.
Let us know if you have any questions or things you would like us to cover in future episodes. We're on Facebook, facebook.com/rockpaperswordspodcast, and Twitter at @rock_swords. You can find out more about our books at matthewharfey.com and stephenamackay.com.
The theme music is written and performed and copyrighted by us. Until next time on Rock, Paper, Swords, it's goodbye from me, Mrs. Doubtfire.
And it's goodbye from me, Stephen A. Mackay.
And remember, whenever... I can't do it. But remember, whatever action and adventure you have going on in your life, be kind.
Stay safe.
And happy reading.